Listening Library presents The Fall of Fergal, or Not So Dingley in the Dell, The First Unlikely Exploit, by Philip Ardagh. Read for you by Joe Barrett.
As far as I'm aware, I'm Philip Ardagh. There's one thing we need to get straight before any of us get started, and that is this. No matter where you think the events in this book took place, you're wrong. Plain and simple, no room for argument. Just because I have the McNally speaking English, it doesn't mean they're from an English-speaking country. If you're listening to a translated version of the book, it doesn't mean they actually spoke the language you're hearing either. No, the events in this book took place somewhere none of you has ever been. How can I be sure? Because I'm the author, that's how, and we'll hear no more about it. Discussion closed. And as for the McNally's names, I know they're strange, but I can't go and change them just to make you happy. Now, can I? That's what they're called, so you'll have to live with it. In the meantime, I hope you enjoy this.
Marley was dead to begin with. There's no doubt whatever about that. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. From A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. Chapter 1. The very last words young Fergal McNally heard in his life were, "Don't lean out of that window!" The very last sounds were probably the air whistling past his sticky out ears as he fell the 14 stories, the honk of traffic horns below, getting nearer and nearer, of course, and possibly the sp of the splat he himself made as he hit the pavement. Fergal certainly wouldn't have heard more than the sp, though, because by the time the lat part had followed, he would have been well and truly dead. The person who'd shouted the "don't lean out" warning good and loud, but far too late, was Fergal's older sister Jackie. Jackie really was an older sister. Some people, twins usually, have older sisters just minutes older than them. Lots of people have older sisters a good few years older than them, but Fergal's sister Jackie was old enough to be his mother, which was kind of handy, because he didn't have a real mother. It had been down to Jackie to bring up the rest of them. You know, feed them, clothe them, stop them from falling out of windows, that kind of thing. Of course, their father could have brought them up, but he was a useless dad. He even went so far as to get a note from his doctor saying that he was excused parenting and left everything for poor old Jackie to do. He kept himself busy by collecting empty bottles. They were full when he first got them, but were certainly empty by the time he'd finished with them. He very rarely spoke to anyone except that man in the bottle shop and a shout at Jackie to tell her how useless she was at everything. He would hide in what he called the back room, though it was more to the side than the back if you counted the front bit of the apartment as being the part that faced the road. He even had his meals in the back room, whilst Jackie fed her brothers and sister once a day around a big circular table in the kitchen. Rufus McNally, that was their father's name, often liked to add to his empty bottle collection during mealtimes and would attract Jackie's attention to bring him another full one by throwing something at the wall dividing the back room, which was really a side room, from the kitchen. Sometimes it'd be a bottle he'd just emptied. Sometimes it might be a boot. Once, he picked up the cat, but Smokey was no fool, and with a few swift strokes of the paw and claw, made it absolutely clear to Captain Rufus that she was by no means a cat of the throwing across the room variety. You see, Smokey was a working cat, not a pet. She let the McNally children stroke her, and she let them love her, but they didn't feed her. It's not that they were mean, it's just that there was barely enough food for themselves without feeding a cat as well. Smokey ate the mice and rats that were unwise enough to stop scuttling behind the baseboard and make a break across an open floor. Once, Fergal's dad Rufus threw his own wooden leg at the wall to attract Jackie's attention. He looked around for something else to throw, but couldn't find anything that wasn't furry and purry, So he'd unscrewed his leg and chucked it with such force that it not only cracked the plaster on the wall, but also split the leg itself, right along the grain. Thereafter, it always looked like an overripe fruit with a burst skin. In the days before any of the children, apart from Jackie, had been born, Rufus McNally had been not only a brilliant sailor, but also a war hero. He'd been a happy, smiling fellow, whom, which is simply a who with an M on the end, everyone had been proud to know. He'd been awarded more gold medals for bravery than he had clean shirts to pin the medals on. And then he'd lost his leg. He didn't lose his leg in the way that people lose umbrellas at busy train stations. No, Captain Rufus McNally lost his leg in such a way that he couldn't simply go to the lost and found and collect it. He didn't lose his leg in an explosion, and he'd been in many of those. He didn't lose it when he was clinging to wreckage in shark-infested waters, and he'd found himself in that predicament on more than one occasion. He lost his leg on the fourth occasion he found himself in a sinking ship. On the previous three occasions, he'd done heroic deeds to save others trapped as their vessels went down. On this final occasion, it was he who was trapped. His ship had been torpedoed by an enemy submarine and was sinking fast, but he was going nowhere because his leg was caught under a mass of twisted metal. So, Captain Rufus McNally did a very brave thing. As the water poured into the cabin where he was trapped, knowing that if he couldn't free himself, he would definitely die, he decided to cut off his own leg. Sorry, but there you are. I'd love to say that the solution was to skip happily with fluffy bunnies with nice music in the background, but this was war. And war is a horrible thing. If you don't want to know the details, stop listening until I tell you that it's safe to carry on. Rufus grabbed a razor-sharp piece of twisted metal that had once been part of a doorframe to the boiler room, if you must know, and cut through his leg. And yes, he did have to hack through his own bone, as the rising water around him reddened with his own blood. At the end of it, he fainted, but he floated free and was rescued by some of his own men who'd made it to a lifeboat. They stemmed the bleeding. People never stop the bleeding in war stories, they always stem it. And fortunately for Rufus, help was close at hand, and he survived. The downside was that he was a changed man. What Rufus McNally went through was unbelievably dreadful. I'd be a liar to tell you otherwise, but other people have been through even worse and somehow come out the other side as decent human beings. Rufus McNally, however, became bitter, sick, and twisted. In that order. He tried twisted, bitter, and sick, but it didn't suit. And it was then that he started to D-R-I-N. Oh, hang on, I almost forgot. It's okay to start listening again, you squeamish ones. From being a popular hero, Rufus turned his back on all his old friends and colleagues and wanted to be alone. He had his war pension, and whenever he needed a bit more money, he'd have his wife, and after she died, Jackie, sell another of his many medals. Poor Jackie. That was just another one of her jobs. No wonder she got a bit snappy sometimes. Fergal and the other kids, his twin brothers Joshua and Albie, and his sister Le Fay, sometimes called Jackie Jackal, which may have seemed a bit mean. Wouldn't you snap and snarl once in a while with four younger siblings to look after and no life of your own? Probably. Although there may, of course, have been more to her name than that. Those of you who listen on shall see. But I'm pretty sure they all loved each other. In fact, I'd go so far as to say that I expect Jackie, Joshua, Albie, and Le Fay, or if you prefer them in alphabetical order, Albie, Jackie, Joshua, and Le Fay, were really upset when their little brother Fergal ended up all dead like that. Splat. The sad thing was that things were looking up for the McNally family at the time Fergal took a nosedive from the window. For a start, it was a hotel window from which Fergal fell. And, although Fergal's other sister, Le Fay, was the only person who was supposed to be occupying the hotel room, it was a single, they'd never been in the position before in which even one of them could legitimately spend the night in a hotel. And the Dell was quite a posh one. Le Fay had entered a typing competition and had won her local and regional finals. No, she was in the National Grand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.